Hey guys, it's Alex again from SkyRC. Before we get into the build, I wanted to mention a couple more things. One thing is on the plane itself. Now this is an F-16, and one reason I picked this is it's a plane I like, and it's one of the last jets that I like that I haven't actually tried to build yet in a profile form. So I've never built this particular set of plans. It is slightly different than the ones I'm used to. I've never flown this type of plane. I did make one attempt a while back at a ducted fan version, but that was a full 3D build, not a profile build. So, I'm learning this as I go too, as far as the little quirks of this particular plane. One thing that I thought was worth mentioning, besides the fact that I hadn't done this plane before, is that it comes with these missile rails here on the ends of the wings, and it actually even has these little missiles you can put on afterward. I'm not sure if I'm going to go with these. First of all, they're a little bit of extra drag and glue, and they're not going to do anything for you structurally. The other thing is, these are going to be the first thing, or even the rails, even if you decide not to put the missiles on, these are going to be the first thing that break. And I feel like they're just going to be constant nuisance. Even if you have good landings, one wing is going to hit the ground at some point, even on a good landing. And I feel like these are just going to rip right out, unless I were to put some sort of like either carbon or barbecue skewer or something in here to reinforce it. So I may be cutting these off. So if you don't decide to do that and you wonder why my plane may look a little different, that's why. That's my reasoning behind it. So just one thing to think about. Again, this is one of the this is the first time I've done this particular plane, but the construction is similar. And I from what I heard, it should be a pretty good flyer. So that's another reason I decided to try to do it. But that's just one thing I noticed that I thought was worth mentioning. Another thing is also on the controls. I'm electing to go ahead and use the ailerons because that will ultimately give me more roll authority when I go to fly. But you do not have to. Most of these planes fly very well just on elevons, so just the back control surfaces. And you could actually just leave these here and not even cut them out. It's actually a little bit simpler that way too, because you have a little bit less linkage to run. But I'm gonna go ahead and try running with the ailerons because I like having the extra control authority. Having the propeller here in the middle of the airplane with the motor up here, it's gonna blow all that thrust right across these surfaces back here, and you should have still pretty good control even with just the back. So I just wanted to mention that. In the next phase now, we'll go ahead and start cutting out for our foam for our carbon wing spar. And that's what I'll be using is carbon. So okay, so now we're at the part where we get to look at our wing spar. Now you'll see I didn't pull the plans off of the foam yet. I wanted to use this board that they included as a kind of a guide. Most of the plans for the park jets will have some sort of mark where the spar should go. So as you can see, the spar runs basically wingtip to wingtip. And I have a couple rods here. These are carbon rods, and then I also have a wooden dowel. I think this is a quarter inch diameter wooden dowel. Now, when I bought my carbon rods, I bought them in a pack of 10, and I've just been using those on all my planes. And when I throw a plane away, I will go ahead and recycle these. But in making the different planes, sometimes you have to cut them a little short. So I actually have two different lengths here. So I have one, and as you can see, it's gonna end up being a bit too short. Significantly too short. Now I could probably make that work if I really wanted to, but since I already have a longer one, I'm gonna like to use that one. And that basically will run wingtip to wingtip. It's actually a slightly longer than what I need it to be, but I don't think I'm gonna worry about cutting it. I think I'm just gonna try to make it work as is. So you don't always have to go by what's on the plans when you go to do this part. I mean, and I could trim this, but I'd rather not, because once you trim it, that's it. If I were to make another plane that happens to have a longer wingspan, then you know I may be in a little bit more of a or may have more of an issue in that case. So, and then here's a wood dowel, and this is actually even longer than the carbon spar. So, the reason I want to talk about this is because depending on the thickness, like this quarter inch dowel is much bigger round. I think this is it's either 3.5 or a 4 millimeter rod, I believe. So the way you cut your slots, you know, you want your spar to fit in there. So just from eyeballing, I think this should fit this just about perfectly if I were to cut what they have here. But if I were to use the dowel is actually wider. Not sure if you can see that, but the dowel is actually wider than the slot, so it has to make it a little bigger. And obviously the length also, if your rod is not exactly this length, then obviously you're just going to cut it to fit your rod. So in this case, what I would recommend doing, if you're going to do, you know, like me and use this rod and this particular length, I'm going to go ahead and probably use this as a guide and cut this out, and then I'll just lengthen the cut as needed to go ahead and fit my rod in here. And if you do need to go wider, you know, I wouldn't go a whole lot wider than whatever you're going to be putting in there, because you want it to be a pretty snug fit. You don't want it so tight that it will warp the wing when you go trying to, you know, squeeze it in there. But you definitely want it, you know, a pretty snug fit when you go to put it in, because that will result in, you know, a lot less glue being needed to fill in the gaps. So and then, you know, if you do have to do it that way, and you know, let's say, you know, even if this wasn't the right size, the way to do it, if you can't use this, you know, you can still, I would use, you know, either the front or the back as my guideline, and then, you know, either with a ruler or whatever, just measure out the distance, and then you know, just, and then with a long ruler, you know, even one thing you can use is, if you don't have a long ruler, you can actually get a fresh piece of the foam board and use that as kind of a straight edge, and you know, make a mark here however wide you want this to be, and use the straight edge and just go all the way down, and you know, you can make a mark on the other end too, and you know, line them up and make a, you know, a nice little line. That way you can fit the spar in here. Sometimes I'll actually lay this down and trace it, but the problem is to keep it straight and steady while you're doing that, especially since it's round, it can be a little tough. I mean, I'll do it that way, you know, occasionally if, you know, if I don't have a long straight edge nearby. It just depends on how you want to do it. But you do want the fit to be snug, and you do want to make sure it's the right length and symmetrical too. I mean, you don't want it to be, you know, offset, you know, all the way on, you know, to this wing tip, but then have a, you know, an inch over there. You want it to be, you know, nice and centered. So I'm going to go ahead and cut that out, and then we'll go to the next step. Okay, so I've got the plans ripped off of the foam now. I've also went ahead and cut my slot for my spar. I went all the way through, and, you know, just about to the end, I just was able to get this to fit in here. Now, one thing you're going to want to do is do a test fit. You want to make sure this fits in here, you know, nice and snug, not a whole lot of gaps, but, you know, will not bind on the edges or anything. You want to make sure, if anything, maybe just leave just a little bit extra on the sides so you have plenty of room to get this thing down in here. Now, the next step is pretty important, because this is going to form the backbone of the plane. Now, what I like to use is the Gorilla Glue. This is the white Gorilla Glue. It's activated by water, so if you were to just, you know, lay a bead down on the foam and let it sit, it would take the moisture out of the air and bubble up. It foams up quite a bit, so it expands to a much larger volume than when you first put it down. Now, when you do it that way, though, it takes a while to dry. So what I like to do is I add my own water, just with a spray bottle. Now, another thing you're going to want to have handy is a paper towel to wipe off the excess water. And then next to last thing you're going to need is tape to seal it all in when you go to put your spar in. And then you're going to want something, you can use a cutting mat or even just, you know, like a, you know, concrete or whatever to lay it down on, something that you don't mind necessarily getting some glue on it. nice and flat and straight. And then you're also going to want something heavy and flat that you can put on top of this while it's drying so that it dries nice and straight and true. What I'm going to use is a scrap piece of wood from an old dresser that's nice and big and flat. And then I'm probably going to lay some toolboxes or something heavy on top of this just to keep pressure on it while it dries. And I would say give it a good half hour to an hour of drying time before you start to try to mess with it. If you can go a little bit longer than that, it's even better. Just to make sure that the glue is fully dried. So the first step will be to go ahead, since we've done our test fit, is lay down some tape. Now, I like to use the 2-inch wide tape. You can use the thinner stuff if you want, but keep in mind that the thinner it is, the more you're going to have to worry about possible glue leaking out on the sides. So I would definitely recommend using the wider tape, or if you're going to use the thinner tape, putting a couple of layers down, as far as, you know, a couple pieces side to side, to make sure that you've got a good, you know, maybe 3/4 inch past the gap on both sides to allow for any possible leakage of glue. Okay. So I got that all laid in there. Now, I got my tape down there. That's what I'm actually going to be setting the rod down. I'm going to make sure this is pushed nice and flat and tight. Okay, so now the next step is going to be laying the glue down. I'm going to put the glue down first. Now, if you're using hot glue or epoxy, you know, you may decide to put the rod in first and then glue on top of it. There's, you know, different ways to do it, but with this way, I like to put the glue down first. And with this, you know, you don't need much. This foams up so much that it's probably better to go on the lighter side as far as the glue, because it's going to fill in this gap in this slot very easily. Okay, so I'm going to start at one end, and you know, it's got about the same consistency as like clear Elmer's glue, if you're used to that. You know, it's a little thicker than your normal wood glue when it goes down as far as its viscosity. But I'm just going to lay a little bead of glue all the way across. Trying to make sure I got it as evenly spread as possible. And then if I see any gaps, I'll come back in here and fill them in. Okay, so the glue's laid in there. Now, I'm going to go ahead and get my spray bottle and go ahead and spray the entire length of the joint. And here is where the paper towel comes in. I'm going to go ahead and now wipe down the excess water that's on the surface, because if you try to do the masking tape over that wet foam, it is not going to stick for you. It may look like it's sticking, but you'll probably end up with glue leaking out, which can be cleaned up later with a knife. It's not the end of the world, but okay, so now I've taken off all the extra water. I'm going to go ahead and drop my spar in. Okay, fits in there nice and good. And now I'm going to lay some more tape on top. Okay, so now I've got tape on the top and the bottom, and I'm going to cover this up with a piece of wood I have. So I end up with something like that. And then I'm going to go ahead and put a couple of toolboxes that I have lying around here to add some weight, because you really want good pressure on this while it dries. And then after about a half hour to an hour, you can probably go ahead and take it apart and pull the tape off. So that'll be the next step. Okay, so I was able to get my spar glued in. Already pulled the tape off. As you can see, everything came out pretty good. This is the side that got a little bit less glue. I believe this is the top, but it ended up being the last side that I taped down. And then you can see the side where I laid the glue down first, how it made a nice little kind of foam filling there. Now, this actually came out pretty good. I didn't have any bubble leaks. I did have to do some cleaning up of the, you can see a little bit of residual tape here. A lot of the tape didn't want to come back off, so I had to go in there with my knife and kind of pick at it to get it all off. But I did get it off. So the next phase is going to be to go ahead and recombine the front of the plane and the back of the plane, because as you remember, well, we had a cut this in two separate pieces because our foam board wasn't big enough to accommodate the entire profile silhouette of the plane in one piece. So we're going to do this pretty much the same way that we did the spar. What I'm going to do is I'm going to lay this down nice and flat, and then I'm going to come in and get my edges lined up, and then I'm going to tape this side, the top of it. So make sure I'm nice and even, pushed as tight against the two pieces as I can, and go ahead and lay some tape down. And then I'm going to do one more piece. Okay, so now I'm going to turn this over. I'm going to have a bit of a hinge. You can kind of see here, I'm going to end up with a gap. You can kind of see it there. So I'm going to fill that gap, that hinge, with glue, and then I'm going to tape over the top of this. And we're going to do the same method for using the water to accelerate the drying of the glue. So I'm going to go ahead and lay a bead down. I'm just going to pick either one set or the other to actually lay the bead of glue down. And you want to make sure it's as thin as you can get away with, because you're not really filling any gaps here. You're just wanting to bond the two pieces of foam. So it's just all surface. You don't really need to fill any gaps. So you really just want to use the minimum amount of glue necessary to just, you know, kind of wet the piece. Okay, now I guess I got a bead of glue laid here on the top piece of foam all the way down. I'm gonna come in with my spray bottle and spray it to get the water on there. Now we get that nice and wet. I'm gonna let it sit back down flat with the tape side down right now. Gonna get my paper towel and go ahead and wipe off the excess, not only water, but there is a little bit of glue that's squeezing out. I'm gonna come back and do it again. Alrighty. So now I'm gonna lay a piece of tape on top, just like before. Push it down, get it as flat as you can. All right, so now, just like before, I'm gonna go ahead and get my little scrap of wood and lay that down. Like so. So that's pretty much what I ended up with. Now, I probably will put a little bit of weight on this. You don't need it as much for this part because, again, you're not really concentrating on expanding the foam to fill a gap. But I may put a little something on here just to kind of hold it down since this wood isn't really that heavy to begin with. And that's going to bond the two pieces. After that's done, we're going to probably go ahead and go on to the control surfaces.